First of all, how many kinds of microphones there are? There are many more than I could have time to do it, but I would basically tell you that there are two kinds that we'll describe to you. One is called dynamic microphone. Dynamic microphone usually is air, vibration in the air goes into a diaphragm. Hello? A diaphragm. This is a windscreen. This is a dynamic microphone because it doesn't need any power. There's no batteries about inside. It's a diaphragm because there's a diaphragm. It's a sheet like a steel speaker. Air transmission, air vibrates, bounce and create electric signal, electric current. Current is interpreted. Yeah, thank you very much. This is a no-no. Okay, so the diaphragm vibrates, and then the circuitry inside is able to interpret the vibration and reproduce it the same way, coming out from another diaphragm, which is the speakers. The speakers have a diaphragm too. It's like a cone, they call it a cone, speaker cone. Mostly they are made of a paper, fake paper, so it vibrates, it beats the air a certain way. So that will repeat this process as it is being recorded. So this is a windscreen. So sometimes you see people had a windscreen there, right? Different color. So they are afraid that your spit would hit it, your wind here. You have 65 miles an hour hitting the screen. So therefore you do not, but you use a dynamic microphone. Dynamic means that it has power. Dynamite, right? Power. It doesn't need any more power, okay? Most dynamic microphones are responsible to amplify human voice. So human voice range is like from about 110, 5 cycles per second, at the lowest, low C, all the way to about 800, 900 cycles per second, 800. 800 would be, 880 would be high A, okay? So, a few more notes up, so 900 or something like that. So human voice range around that area. But our human ear can hear down to 20 cycles per second, all the way up to 20,000. So when you hear description of microphone, you see by a microphone, they will chart for you, right? From what range, 55 to 20,000 hertz. most microphones can only pick up to about 15,000. Beyond that is ambient noise. So they're lying to you when they say 20,000 hertz. First of all, you can't hear them much. Number two, it would never produce that. Only through circuitry, they will produce a higher than 1,500. So most microphones pick up to 15,000 hertz, okay? My voice can. So this is already a windscreen. Now this mic is very famous. It's your Shure SM58. On sale, it could be $99. Not on sale, they're $149. Okay. The Guitar Center sells this a lot. This is the most popular microphone. You see any speaker, they will have this kind of microphone there. Shure, S-H-U-R-E, SM58. Now you should get your own microphone. Because I'm speaking to it, and you come and use it, and my germs get into you, right?
They also produce, Shure also manufactures sound isolating.
Oh yeah.
Headphones.
Yeah, Sony, Shure, they all do that. Very nice. You go on the airplane, and you can screen out the noise, right? Okay, so that's another subject matter. It's very interesting. So these microphones are called cardioid, C-A-R-D-I-O-D. Cardioid, C-A-R-D-I-O-D. Okay, cardioid microphone means cardioid, means heart, the heart, right? So heart shape. So that, in other words, the response of this mic is effective right here, center. Right here, but not here, not here, not here, not here. Not much, right? Wow. See, it's not being amplified through the speaker. See? So then, effective range is between 3 inches to 1.5 to 3 inches. That area, okay? Handheld mic. The advantage of these mics are that it will not amplify anything beyond 18 inches. Not much, right? The rest of it is the reverberation, natural reverberation in this hall. So by 18 inches or so, no effect. So in order to test your microphone, okay, a split distance makes a lot of difference in terms of amplification. Now this could be 1.5 times. 1.5 times. 1.5 times, right? Now this could be 4 times. This could be 8 times. This could be 16 times. 32 times, right? So now, in order to find your mic, you buy your mic, so all mics are being abused. Once it's bought brand new from the store, it will be subjected to abuse, right? You abuse it, your friends abuse it, you drop it, and so forth. So it will decrease sensitivity. So then, if you have your own mic, you're protected. You're protected. So make sure, right, it's not being used by somebody else. All these germs getting in. I want to tell you, I don't have any germs now because it's gone. Flu is only contagious at the beginning stage. So this is tail end. Okay, yes, Cindy. Oh, I stand myself upside down and something comes out all the time.
So it's still there?
Yes.
That's not painful?
If we're being recorded, so. Okay. That's besides the point. Thank you for your love and concern. So, when you use the mic, please make sure that you keep it the same distance. The sound tech is going to be very angry with you if you go like this all the time. Okay, so don't do that at all. So keep the same distance. Also, make sure that your air flow will not directly hit the windscreen under inside. So what I say, what you do is you say, P, hey, P, 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 right here. Going down about 30 degrees down, straight here. So 30 degrees down. So make sure you don't get your mic right there at that point. That's called pop, okay? Microphone pops. So don't do that at all. So what you do is put it next to your chin. It's very down. Your teeth, push it down, right? So right here is fine. So in studio recording, they have it right here. Some singers have the microphone right here. Hidden behind the hair. So girls have the hair, right? So you can put it right here. And put makeup on so you won't see it. Or put it here. See? Right here is perfect. See? It's perfect. It won't have pop sound. I won't pop. Okay?
So like singing upside down?
Upside down is fine. Voice actually travels, you know, remember. Voice, mid-range sound travels 45 degrees up. So therefore in studio, they have all this microphone hanging down because they're picking you up. But this is a close-up microphone for voice. So its frequency response do not have to be very high. 15,000 is too high. 12,000 is fine because the electronics is going to help you enhance it a little bit. You don't have so much that high because the high frequency, your ear may not hear the volume, but it is there. So we'll pick it up and we'll soon react to the acoustics of the room and give you what we call feedback. I'll explain what feedback is. So make sure when you hold the microphone, make sure that it is close, always within 2 inches. 1.5, 2 inches, always. Don't try to be hero. Okay, like this. If you have a microphone stand, then stay within that distance. Unless you're so used to your own voice and your own microphone, you want that supposed to be a sound where you begin to soften up, and you can't soften too much. You go, oh, like that, right? That way, the amplification there would have a feeling of fading away. Well, you are not fading away, but the mic is. The mic is fading away. So very important. And also, you see this mic is made of lead, very heavy lead. So you don't crack the plastic, you touch the plastic, microphone, clack, 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 all kind of noise. This, we don't have any noise there. So no impact noise. Some pop singers, they want people to applaud, right? See? So they are all taught not to do this. They will do just... They are not really doing it. Or else they go like that, right? So don't do that, because that will give additional noise, okay? So now, most importantly, within 2 inches all the time, and away from the airflow. Now this is called a vocal dynamic microphone, okay? There are microphones that need extra power to pick up from a longer distance, and I'll explain that to you. This is called a shotgun, okay? It's got a wide range microphone, shotgun. Shotgun can pick up to 12 feet, okay, 12 feet away. And it will decrease quality. And also you must know, when it crosses 12 feet, like from here to James, so 12 feet, right? About 12 feet, you're picking up also the air noise in between, the air, okay? So you will lose high fidelity. Okay, high fidelity means true to the real sound. So you lose sound. But some microphones are very, very good. Have you seen a parabola microphones? Parabola. That's distance microphone. Like an umbrella. Like this. Now I can pick up, you know, more. Because this is directing. The sound bounces into this mic. Okay. It's very, very, very important a feature. The problem, the advantage of this is that you can go far further, even further, more than shotgun. So you see in some movies, there are FBI, umbrella, right? So, or your satellite dish, picking up signal, right? See, your satellite, anyone has a satellite dish at home? Go to the satellite, bounce into the receptor. See? So now here, for these microphones, you usually end up having to have electric condenser, electric condenser microphone. What it does is it amplifies the quality of sound, not only just the volume, but the frequency range too. So they say that you can hear a thin drop, right? So if it is this far, okay, on a hard rock surface, you drop a pin, you can pick up the sound because it is electronically amplified. Now, those microphones are not good for singers. Now, another advantage of the cardioid dynamic microphone is that it will eliminate most feedback problems. Feedback is a major issue in recording. The feedback means that your voice is amplified 8 times here, 8 times coming out from there, right? If that 8 times feedback into the microphone will be 8 times 8, 64 times. In split second, it's going to be so loud, you'll hurt your eardrum. So that's called feedback. Feedback is the completing of the amplification circle, coming back. So if I have something play out from there, not from here, but from there, my mic could be recording here without having any feedback. But if I say amplify from here, coming out, it will. See, if it's in the same circuit, so this one goes to the amplifier, and it goes to the speaker, it comes here. There's one circle. Now, one circle, once the circle back, it's called feedback. Feedback. Now, these microphones are good for that, for getting away, doing without any feedback. But any of these microphones will pick up feedback very fast. See, if you have it, you're a singer, right? You're singing like that, huh? You're singing, really enjoying yourself, but 8 feet pick up. So immediately, boom, 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 boom. See? Okay? So what you do is you deaden your background, deaden by a thick curtain. This is too thin, about 3 inches curtain, 2 inch carpet. All the way on the wall, okay? And then try to So the speaker is far away from this direction. So both podium microphones are shotgun or wide angle because they have to pick up farther away. Right? Most speakers speak microphone right here. So they have special design microphones for podium, okay, for recording distance, so forth. But there are some microphones that are so good, electric condenser microphone, that if you pick up like this and have a sound baffle, like a right angle here, and then a microphone here to record, you will not pick up anything but your sound. The wall absorbs it, so it won't bounce any. The walls absorb sound baffles. So like an angle. So whatever you come, even if there's any deflection, it will come back to the microphone. Right? So then you can isolate, people can talk in behind the wall, nothing can be recorded. Okay? So those are important you need to know. So most people when they sing pop singers, karaoke conscious. And so louder. They want their speaker, the monitor to be louder. The sound tech said, no, I can't be any louder. That idea is important to know because sound can saturate a room. Sound is beating air. So if the room is big, it's harder to have any feedback. If the room is small, it's saturated, then you'll come back to bounce all over the place, come back here. So once the room is saturated, sound tech say, I resign, bye-bye. Don't ask me to play any more louder to you. So what they do is put you on a headphone. Right? So they play the music to your ear instead of having to deal with the acoustic problems of the room. Okay? Each room has its own frequency. Like for example, the elevator there, I showed you before, elevator that we have here is on B flat. So when you go down there, elevator, close the door, as it's going up, you go, the whole elevator shakes with sound. Because that's the pipe. Resonate on B flat. So then this room has a certain frequency. The walls are not parallel. So therefore it's dealing away with the bouncing back resonance. You see, the room is like a speaker. See? So therefore, when I speak, bounce to the wall, come to you. Bounce to the top, it won't come to you. If it is a bigger room, you need more sound. These sound bubbles, it's not sound bubbles, they're soundproofing material. They would bounce back the sound. So when sound goes out there, it bounces to the audience. Speakers are supposed to point at the audience, not point at the walls. So therefore, these speakers are slightly down like that. It should be further down because it's supposed to hit you. So you absorb the sound also. If you hit directly straight to the wall, it will bounce back and then you have resonance issue, saturation of sound issue. So therefore, the bigger the auditorium is, the easier sound tech in fact it is. Okay, so of course then it has its own problem too. Now, these microphones you don't want to touch. Just get this, because you're a singer. If you are recording a concert, then you may want to use these microphones. But you need to know how to place them. Okay? How to place speakers too. Speakers are supposed to be distributing the sound, right? Not blasting the front row. See what I'm saying? Distribution of sound. If your hall is too long, there's a delay effect. So you need to digitally delay the sound so that it will sound natural. See, delay the speakers over there with something like a split second later. So you can hear the acoustics. See, so otherwise we have some reverberation issues. Off and off. Okay. Speaker. Now speakers are important because it will reduce your sound, right? So for human voice, like I said, it's from 110 all the way to 9,000. 900, 1,000, not much. 15,000 is a lot, right? So if you need, I'll give you a frequency chart that tells you what instrument, what rate here. Okay, so I'm not going to talk too much on this one. I thought about feedback already. Human voice rate, I thought about that already. That's what I've already. So now the speaker, there is a equipment, it's the last part of my instruction. The most important part is when you by a pair of speakers, they will tell you the frequency response, right? The best way to do that is to use what we call pink noise or white noise. Okay, white noise is noise, any noise, any frequency at any volume. Usually it sounds like that. The sound. Now, pink noise, P-I-N-K, pink noise is every possible frequency produced at an even, progressively even volume. So it is not a straight line, but rather a curved line like this. Or to your ear, it is higher in the bass and then lower, or higher in the high and lower in the bass. Depends on the effectiveness of that speaker, that particular speaker. You want a speaker to produce a frequency which is a straight line, either curved like this, slanted, or not. Straight line is important. So there are microphones that can pick up, okay, pink noise, and then analyze whether your speaker is producing every frequency evenly. That's what you need, okay? So, and then also there are speakers who could play good sound and play to your microphone and analyze the microphone, see your microphone is pick up every frequency equally. So there's also another thing, the last part of this is called an equalizer and the spectrum analyzer. Equalizer is like you have 32 bands. 32 band equalizer is like every three or four notes on a piano, you have one band, adjust the volume. Okay? You can do that. So you can adjust the volume for every three notes on a piano. Okay? So now, if your speaker is very strong playing on C, D, or E, you can lower it. So the frequency spectrum will be even, straight across. Okay, so that's the equalizer. Equalizer and adjust that. Then that spectrum analyzer would be picking up your speaker and tell you which is louder, which frequency is louder. Then the equalizer would lower those which is louder and raise those which are softer. So you have maintained a good even flow. Questions? These speakers are not for PA. Okay. Because they are for music. When once you record into an album, the recording system here balances the sound. So for voice, you're giving a punch, P-U-N-T, a punch. So that punch have to be dealt with without breaking the cones of the speaker. So these speakers are high fidelity speakers. They're not for PA. So they're for music. So therefore, we are responsible to break one of those. I don't know if they replace it or not. Right? See one of those, and you see the frequency response is different. You can hear it. This one. The mid range is done. So that's important. So you buy PA speakers. Don't buy high fidelity speakers for your home system. In my house, I have a PA system and also a high fidelity system. High fidelity system, I play my music, a karaoke music, everything recorded. Then the PA system is my voice because the cones are made of metal, metallic, so bang, you're powerful. It can withstand any vocal punch. Okay? That's all. Whoa, 20 minutes. Okay, turn it off. Then we can ask any questions. Too bad my voice is thunder. Questions?
The last part you said is speaker. PA speaker is a good for music. What is the
PA is for voice.
A voice?
Yeah.
Okay.
These high fidelity speakers are not for voice.
This is high definition. This
yeah, high fidelity. Yeah, high fidelity. Yeah, high definition is fine. Okay. These are not digital, those are analog. Okay. Your sound is your sound in your system is digital. So when you play it out here, it's analog. Actually, digital sound is not as clear as analog sound. Because digital sound is divided into the resolution. How small each division is, like your monitor, right? 19, 20 dots across, right? And it's very, very high density. But digital is every, there's a gap between every resolution, sound resolution. Analog, there's no gap. So therefore, these guys or girls who love music, love the PA system, can tell them, like me, I prefer tube amplifier than digital. The tube amplifier gives you such a solid, powerful, full sound. A digital is just giving you plastic sound. You really big, whoa, right? But there's resolution issue. The more high fidelity, the more money it takes. Because it's just, okay. So as a screen has resolution, sound has resolution. Mario. Oh, it depends on the mic. So there's some of the mics are condenser because they are farther away, but they are cardioid condenser. See? So once you have, there's another thing, continue to record. You turn off the whole thing?
You told me to.
Oh yeah, but not the whole thing. This is, am I still on screen?
You are not.
Oh, okay, yeah, so.
You want to go? We go
yeah,
back
go,
and
go,
then
go back. No, no, no,
that,
just
that,
press the recording
the
button.
Okay.
Just press the recording button. Okay, that's still recording the computer. Okay, your question was?
The question was the quality of the sound.
Yeah.
If you would get as good quality, if you have the mic, you can attach this way or this way.
Yeah, very good question. Most of these microphones are condenser, electric condenser microphones. But the danger of that is because it is omnidirectional. This is cardioid. This is also one direction. Unidirectional. These are all unidirectional. One direction. But there are microphones that are omnidirectional. O, M, and I. Omnidirectional. That means that the mic is here. It's going all around. All around. Three dimension, all around, here, everywhere. So then, those wires are not very, very, very easy to work with, because when you put it over here, everything. Okay, like for example, this recorder, this video, a camera, has five channels: center, left, right, back, left, right. So 5.1. This is 5.1, not 7. It's 5.1. My house 7.1. I have 7 speakers. Now this 5.1, so it records everywhere. So it records behind you, YouTube. See, but concentrate on the center. So a little bit of cardioid, but it's cardioid omnidirectional. Okay, 5.1. Okay, so some of the microphones that are here, because they're so close to your mouth, some microphones nowadays are plugged into your ear too. It picks up from inside your ear, which is a very, very odd sound. But they somehow they use a circuitry to decipher the muffled sound. Have you ever put your ear to the back of your friend and they talk like that? They are able to pick it up, okay? And I don't know how, somehow something is out here to pick up. So those are, some mice are bone transmission. Use bone transmission over here. Okay. Okay, good. That was just a supplement. Omnidirectional and omnidirectional and unidirectional microphones. Okay. So once you have omnidirectional, you better be careful because everywhere you pick up audience, everything. So those are good mics for putting in the audience and record the response of the audience. And these are unidirectional. Okay, very good. I'll add it together. Yes.
For
singers, because of pop music created this mic, because they have so much sound, the speaker blasting up the trumpet, right? So they don't want this voice to pick up all this music around the man. So therefore they have it closed down to about 2-3 inches. So other than that, they can't pick up much. If they have a condenser, omnidirectional microphone, a single thing, then you'll be in big trouble. Because you pick up everything. And all the feedback, everywhere, bounce all over the place. So you isolate the microphone in the middle just to record the response of the audience. So use a little bit of it, adjust to the right amount. Now, recording must be done in isolation. Continue. Recording must be done in isolation because you don't want to hear the acoustic sound. You want to hear what is being recorded. Okay? So many people don't understand that. I could record this concert from Big Store upstairs, a mile away. If I can wire it over there, I don't need to be here. But for you, acoustic control, the sound tech is needed. Because he is there. Now, the sound tech must not sit behind in some room. Must not do that. It must be in the audience. So the control panel must be situated in the center of the audience or at the back. And up there, if you're up there, fine. But if you open the window, you close the window so that they can talk inside. The recording artist, right? And the recording tech. They are supposed to open all the windows so you can hear exactly what is being amplified, what is wrong, what is better, how to adjust it for the audience. Now that is something that you must know. Some people years in working in an industry do not understand this principle. Many churches, many halls, they just put community hall, put a sound tech in the corner. No good, have to be in the audience.
So, in that case, the studio recording and the audience recording should be in the same quality?
No, not the same.
No.
Give an example. I have one performance. I have an amateur person to help me, right? So I said to this person, I said that we have not enough violins and the flute, not enough pop music. Orchestra, no problem, like the instruments to balance everything, instrument and pick up there. And then they have this flutist, playing one flute. I need that sound to be amplified, right? So they put a mic there. And then the videographer came to tell me, no problem, I'll help, no problem. What he did, he said to me, I just need to plug in to the sound module, fine. I said, no, you can't. So I'm so busy, I'm a director. I can't go there and do every detail. So I threw away his tape. I pay him, but you know, in his tape, he only can hear the flute, nothing else. Because he plugged in to the soundtrack, sound booth. Because sound booth do not need to amplify the choir, do not need to amplify the brass section. So I hear the strings and the flute all the time. And he is, Dong Kok Jie Mai. That means he's into it, he gave it to me. Oh, here's $2,000. I was about to kick his butt, you know. I told you not to do that. And you plug in, you think you're real, real good, right? He thinks he's very good, so, oh no, but I'm just plugging this. No, you can't do that. Don't worry about it, you have to do your thing, I'll do mine. I have never used that videotape because of that issue. Each taping has a different issues, but that one I cannot stand. Okay, so with all the recordings we have done in our performance in choir and orchestra performances, I don't like them, but that's the best I can get.
So, what is the strategy? For example, you have a symphony and some solo, like a violin. You want all the sound for the same quality.
Yeah. So what I do is the amplification, one set of problem, right? Recording another set. What I do is go into the recording room isolated. There, without seeing everything, no view, right? I will hear everything if I'm musical. So then I will place the microphone in the right places. This microphone will not go into the speakers, only go into the recording room. So I will place the microphone, so two sets of microphones. The acoustics set could be, oh, I need the flute to be amplified. I need the string to amplify a little more. Okay, we have only a few altos. I need the bass, I need a little more. So then you could sit there. So all sound tech has to be musical. If they are not musical, fire. They need to hear the balance of the choir. Of course, then it's ideal to have a quietness balance already, right? So they only just put a microphone there. That's good enough, right? Two microphones, stereo, right? That's good enough, provided that they are all balanced. We are not in our choir performance. We are not balanced. So I cannot ask for any more, okay? And then the last time the trombones are blasting out, taking off, taking over everything. What can I do? It's a very important record event. You were there, right? The Mozart Requiem. Last time was better. Yeah, the Haydn was good.
Yeah.
So you have a DVD, right? So it's nice for her to remember. And next time when you and your grandchildren coming, anyways, that's a very important issue. So, if you like to learn how to do that,
I know how to add it to sound.
Yeah.
My question is sometimes if you want to, for example, pick up the noise, you want to pure your sound, and then hardly to get the track, right track.
Yeah.
That's why I'm.
No, I recorded quite a few events. None of them are satisfactory. You're not giving me enough time to study the acoustics of the room. So therefore, having your own studio, a Paramount studio, you know the acoustics. Whatever you do, you exactly know how to do it. But if you go to a new space all the time, new hall, new all of that, nobody should be crazy enough to take up a job.
And
because you've never done that in that room.
The late stage of editing cannot do much work.
You cannot do much. After post-production is limited. So therefore you do a lot of takes, you know, to edit. But live, so all my recordings of my singing were live recording. No studio work. I don't believe in studio work. Okay, very good. Yes.
Do you ever put ribbon mics on people whose voice is too weak?
I have done so, but if their voice is very nice, very even, yeah. But it is hard to do because that person is immediately feel that they are being isolated out. Right? I just put a mic closer to a certain level, certain area. Okay, let's take a break.